good morning, church. Come on, let's stand and sing together this morning. It's so good to see you this morning. Trustworthy. We worship a God who we can put our hope in. Come on, we're going to sing about that this morning. Yeah. Sing, your word is a lamp. Come on.
Your word is a lamp unto my feet. Your way is the only way for me. It's a narrow road that leads to life, but I want to be on it.
Yeah, come on.
It's a narrow road, but the mercy's wide, because you're good on your promise.
Come on, sing it out.
I'll take you at your word. If you say,
you spoke,
and the chaos fell in line. Oh, I know, because I've seen it in my life. It's a narrow road that leads to life, but I want to be on it.
Come on, sing that again.
It's a narrow road, the tide is high,
but you parted the waters. together. You said your love. Come on.
You said your love would never give up. You said your grace is always enough. You said your heart would never forget or forsake me. You said I'm saved. You call me yours. You said my future's full of your hope. You never fail, so I know that you'll never fail me.
Come on, we say.
You said your love would never give up. You said your grace is always enough. You said your heart would never forget or forsake me.
Oh, you said I'm saved.
You said I'm saved. You call me yours. You said my future's full of your hope. You've never failed, so I know that you'll never fail me. I'll take you out your.
Come on, we say.
If you said it, I'll believe it. I've seen how good it was. If you start.
Come on, church. Do we believe that today? Do we believe that he's trustworthy? Yeah. Man, it's so good to see you all. You'll go ahead and have a seat real quick. If we haven't gotten to meet yet, my name's Grant, and I'm the minister of worship and connections here at North Pointe. And it's so good to see you all today. I'm excited that you're here as we are in week number 7 of our series, The Big Picture. And if you are a guest with us today, I would love the opportunity to get to know you, and the best way that we can do that is with the Connect card located at the host team table. And so if you would just fill out as much of that as you're comfortable with, put it in the bucket at the end of service, we'd love to give you a gift in exchange for that card. Also, if you're worshiping with us online today, if you could just text NPBCGUEST to 95577. We'd love to connect with you that way as well. Well, church, we're going to continue in worship. I'm going to pray for us, and we're going to continue this one. Let's pray. Lord, we worship you this morning with everything that we have. And God, we give you praise. Lord, we believe that there's nothing impossible for you. Lord, we believe that there is power in your name. Lord, we believe that when we call on the name of Jesus, that there is nothing that can stand in the way. Lord, we give you our worship today with everything that we have. It's your name we pray. Amen. Come on, church, let's stand and worship together this morning.
Just a mention makes a way. Just
Church, do we believe that this morning? I say, do we believe it? Come on, let's sing. I see you take it. Jesus, we give you our worship right now. There is no one more deserving of it. There's no one more deserving of our worship, of our praise. But we give it to you today. There was a moment when the lights went out, when death claimed its victory. The King of love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. Before the earth began to shake,
yeah, come on,
and the veil was torn, what sacrifice was made as the heavens roared, and all hail King Jesus. The same. Church, would you lift your hands with me this morning? All hail King Jesus. Come on. Yeah. And all hail King Jesus. And all hail the Lord of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus. All hail. Sing it one more time. All hail. Lift it up to him today. He's worthy. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. And all hail the Savior. Lord, that is the cry of our hearts this morning. All hail you. There's no one more deserving of our worship than you. There's no one more deserving of our time than you. There's no one more deserving of our affections, of our energy, of our finances than you. Lord, you deserve it all. We give it all to you. Lord, we worship you this morning with everything that we have, not just words on a screen. Lord, let those words be the cry of our hearts this morning. All hail King Jesus. We give you praise today. It's in your name we pray. Everybody said, amen. Y'all go ahead and have a seat.
Sorry, thought I broke the mic. Good morning, church family. Good to see you. If you have your Bibles today, we will be in Isaiah 53. You can start turning there. I don't know if you're excited about Fall Fest like I am. It's going to be a great time. Can't wait to minister to our community and just reach people. It's going to be hot air balloons. I mean, hello. Like, what more do you need right there? I'm not getting in it. Someone else can. I'm scared of heights. But I will watch you risk your life all you want right there. It'll be all sorts of fun. Was just talking to one of the kids about Halloween. Yeah, I think they're going to come as Spider-Man. I'm excited about that, right? I mean, I love seeing all the different superhero outfits coming. I may or may not come as Superman past his prime, but you may see me in an outfit like that. I don't know who you think is a superhero in your life. Maybe Wonder Woman for the ladies out there. The world today has changed. It's added so many different superheroes. You got Spider-Man now. There used to be always, like, Superman and Batman. I don't know if you notice it. Now, like, Iron Man came in the picture. I don't know where, like, all of a sudden that came. Captain Marvel, Spider-Man, anybody else? No one really cares about the rest of them. But, you know, if you're one of those people, cool for you. It's crazy to see all the heroes that have come on the scene. For some reason, no one dressed up as a pastor for a superhero. I don't understand why that is. Or a connecting group teacher. So, you know, I don't know if you feel that. I'm going to be that next year. I'm going to dress up as a connecting group teacher. That's what it's going to be. I don't know what that'll look like. One of you may know. I don't know. I don't know where I was going with that whole tangent, but we're in the Bible today. We're in a series called The Big Picture. We've been walking through how the entire Bible is one big narrative telling a story. And maybe you've never seen it like that before. It's all telling a story pointing to something, which we're going to culminate today of what it's pointing to. If you don't know, last week we were in 2 Samuel 7 looking at what we thought God was talking about, how God promised a hero that was going to come. And he's talking about this, what we come to know as the Messiah that's going to come and renew and make things right in this everlasting kingdom. And we saw in 2 Samuel chapter 7, David's on the scene. And you got to understand how significant this character is. David is prosperous. I mean, everyone for the rest of their lives going forward, looking back like, man, I want to get back to those good old days, the glory days. You know what I'm talking about? Younger adults, you know, your grandparents talk about, grandparents you talk about all the time, whatever it is. If you were in high school, when I was in high school, the glory days, whatever it is, man, they're always looking back at when they were prosperous and victorious. And when we pick up in 2 Samuel 7, Israel is established. and they're settled. Which you got to understand the significance. They've been wandering through the wilderness. They've been in the wilderness for years. Before that, where they were in slavery, they were looking, dreaming of this day. They finally arrived. I mean, there's part of them like, what more could you want? It seems like our relationship with God is where it is. I mean, we're established, we're settled, we're prosperous. Things are looking great for Israel right now. And then God comes and says, hey, listen, there's a better hero going to come. A better one's going to come on the scene, a Messiah, an anointed one that's going to do all sort of stuff. I mean, imagine yourself in a situation you can only begin to imagine. Like, how could things get any better? Like, how could life be better than this? Could we be more prosperous? Could we have more territory? Could we be more well-known? I mean, think of what's going through their mind. I tell you this because you have to understand their frame of mind before Jesus comes on the scene to understand the challenge Jesus came into. You don't appreciate it because you know the end of the story. You know how the story comes together. God tells them, like, I'm going to bring someone that's going to restore the world. It's going to bring harmony. It's going to fix all the mess that's been made. And he describes him as one who will establish an eternal kingdom, a kingdom that will last forever. Imagine yourself in their shoes. Like, what is this going to look like? I mean, things look nothing but good. And then you go four chapters later in 2 Samuel 11, a situation with David, and he has an affair with a lady named Bathsheba. And everything begins to fall apart. Like, if you want to talk about a turning point, it's right there where everything looks good, it peaks, and then everything begins to go south. David doesn't live up to his calling. He says, like, you know what, I've been fighting for a long time. We seem to win every battle. You guys got it. I'm going to hang back. And in his hanging back, refusing to live in the calling God has for him, he goes on the roof, sees this beautiful woman bathing, like, I want her. I'm the king. I get what I want. Bring her to me. Has an affair. Does an unthinkable, and this things go south quick, and all falls apart. His kingdom starts to fall apart. It begins to fight inner turmoil. Everything goes south from that point on. Like, the next 800 years after David, you have 400 years of the kingdom in turmoil. David's kingdom gets divided under his grandson, Rehoboam, who is Solomon's son. It falls apart, and you have a north and southern kingdom that's split. And the northern kingdom is the northern kingdom of Israel. And you see in 2 Kings chapter 17, you don't have to turn there, but just listen to what I'm saying, the demise and the fall of that kingdom. Listen to this. This is in the ninth year of Hoshea, the king of Assyria, captured Samaria. So he deported the Israelites and cast them out. In verse 7, it says, this disaster happened. Why? Because the people of Israel sinned against the Lord their God, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt from the power of Pharaoh the king, because they worshipped other gods. It says they abandoned all the commands of the Lord their God. They made cast images for themselves, two calves, and they bowed and worshipped into the stars and skies. They sacrificed their sons and daughters in the fire to Baal. It says, therefore, the Lord was very angry with Israel, and he removed them from his presence. Only the tribe of Judah remained. But even Judah, we come to find out, did not keep the commands of the Lord, their God, but lived according to the customs of Israel and practice. So the Lord rejected all the descendants of Israel and punished them and handed them over to the plunderers until he had banished them from his presence. You have the northern kingdom fall apart. You have the southern kingdom of Judah demise in 2 Chronicles chapter 36. The exact same rinse, cycle, repeat, man. They abandon the Lord. We got this. We don't need him. They leave, and everything falls apart. And from this point on, the kingdom ends, and they're conquered and put into exile and being taken by other people. Imagine yourself. Wait a second. My grandpa told me that there was going to be a kingdom coming forever. David's kingdom would last forever. What? Something has gone wrong. And that's the first 400 years after David. And the next 400 years after that is a distance between Malachi to Matthew. It is 400 years of called the intertestamental period, where it's complete silence. 400 years of not a single word from the Lord. Nothing. Think about that for a second. Seeing God act, seeing God move, and suddenly not a word. 400 years. To give you perspective, the U.S. has only been a country for 246 years. As a matter of fact, the Mayflower came in 1620. That's 402 years ago was when the Mayflower came and landed over here and they began to settle. Now imagine that amount of time of nothing, not a single word. As a matter of fact, if you ever went to Malachi, the very last book of the Old Testament, God talks about the day of the coming of the Lord. Now look at this. Look at this right here. Here's Malachi. And then here's Matthew. You say, what's that? That's 400 years in that flip of a page of nothing. Can you imagine what you'd be going through? The doubt, the questions, all this sort of stuff, the waiting. Man, God promised a new and better David. Someone better than David would come. And then rumors of a new king, a Messiah, emerges in Matthew chapter 1. You're under the oppression and rule of Rome at this point. Imagine what's going through your mind. Man, we've been waiting for this day, and suddenly you hear this. Here's the account of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. As a matter of fact, an angel of the Lord shows up to this guy's dad named Joseph. It says this, and the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because what has been conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit, and she'll give birth to a son. And you're named Jesus, because he will save his people from his sins. And all this took place to fulfill the word of the Lord. You fast forward to the last king, there's excitement, man. Maybe this is the one it's talking about. Everything has been building up to this moment. The entire Old Testament that we've written right there, have read, is building up to this moment right here. Can you imagine the excitement if you're the person hearing rumors of the promised one, the Messiah, is on the scenes? It's come. The day has come. And excitement does build, because you see later on they're celebrating the promised king. In John chapter, in the Bible somewhere, in John chapter 12, verse 12, it says this, talking about Jesus coming in. It says, the next day when the large crowd had come to the festival and heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, they took palm branches and went out to meet him, and they kept shouting, Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. The king's here. Can you believe it? God has finally done what he's going to do. And you come to the end in Matthew 27, this king you've been waiting for, and listen what happens. And I ask you, just listen and follow along with what I'm going to read. It said, now Jesus stood before the governor. He said, are you the king of the Jews? The governor asked him, and Jesus answered, you say so. And while he's being accused by the chief priests and the elders, he didn't answer. Then Pilate said to him, don't you hear how much they have testifying against you now? But he didn't answer them on even one charge, so the governor was quite amazed. So at the festival, the governor's custom was to release to the crowd a prisoner they wanted. And at the time, they had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had gathered together, Pilate said to them, who is it you want me to release, Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ, the Messiah, in other words? For he knew it was better to, it was because of envy they had handed him over. And while he was sitting on the judge's bench, his wife sent word, have nothing to do with this righteous man, for today I've suffered terribly in dreams because of him. And the chief priests and the elders, however, persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to execute Jesus. His own people are saying this. And the governor asked them, which of the two do you want me to release to you? Barabbas, they answered. Pilate asked them, what should I do then with Jesus, who is called the Christ? They all answered, crucify him. And he said, why? What has he done wrong? But they kept shouting all the more, crucify him, crucify him. And when Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that riot was starting to instead, he took some water, washed his hands in front of the crowd, and said, I'm innocent of this man's blood. See to it for yourself. And all the people answered, his blood be on us and our children. And then he released Barabbas to them, and after them, having Jesus flogged, handed over to be crucified. Crucified. They'd lead him up to a place called Golgotha, a place of skull. They would mock him, put robes, a crown of thorns on his head. They would nail a sign on top of this cross. Here is the King of the Jews in several different languages. Here's the promised one. And he's placed in verse 38, we see between two criminals who are crucified with him. And they begin mocking him, laughing him, and pour shame on him. And verse 45 says, from noon until 3 in the afternoon, darkness came over the whole land. About 3 in the afternoon, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which is, my God, why have you abandoned me? And some of those standing there heard them. They said, he's calling to Elijah. Immediately one of them ran and got the sponge and filled it with sour wine and put it on a stick and offered him a drink. But the rest said, let's see if Elijah will come and save him. But Jesus cried out again and with a loud voice gave up his spirit. There has to be a mistake. Place yourself in their shoes. What they came from with David. an established, powerful king that saw victory, success after success, and this nobody guy named Jesus, born in a house of a carpenter from the lowest of lowest family. And they start to believe, and then suddenly it's like, this isn't it, and they crucify him. What do we do with this? There has to be a mistake. Like, where's the new and better David we were promised? Because this guy, I'm telling you right now, cannot be it. Let me just ask you something to make this a little bit relatable to maybe to you today. Have you ever had to come to terms with expectations versus reality? Have you ever had to come to terms like, this is what I thought I was getting myself into, but then the reality hit of, this is not what I expected? Anybody who's been married for a little bit of time knows what I'm talking about right now. I don't need to get an amen because you're probably next to your spouse and we want to keep this peaceful right now. Every time I do premarital counseling, we begin to talk about expectations. Emily and I just like to look at each other and chuckle, like, praying for you. It took me about 3 to 6 months in to realize that this is not what I thought. It took Emily about 2 days, but it took me like 3 to 6 months to go, this is not what I expected. I remember thinking when we were dating, like, man, this is going to be so awesome. Like, I have so much fun with it. Life is great. Like, we get along so, like, I don't understand why people have trouble with this. And we got married, like, this is going to be the rest of our life. And we got married, we're like, what happened? This isn't what I signed up for. See, there's a problem between expectations versus reality. You see, we fantasize about expectations and we get neglect reality. Well, let me just say like this. What do you do when you want a David but get Jesus instead? Now, let me say it a different way. What happens when David is what you want but Jesus is what you really need? When you spent your whole life looking for David, man, I can't wait for this day. I can't wait for this kingdom. I can't wait for this. And you get this, and you're like, what do I do with this? This can't be it. I've read the Bible. I know it inside and out. You want to talk about people that knew the Bible, the Jewish people knew the Bible. Man, this cannot be it. There's no way. And today you see is this, is that Jesus is the unlikely hero we need. There's a big idea I can tell you is Jesus is the big idea. Jesus is the big idea. He's the point of the whole thing. Jesus is the hero we need. Now you might say, well, how is Jesus possibly our hero? How do you get to that point? Hopefully you're in Isaiah 53 so I can show you. This wasn't a blindsided thing. This is something God told them all along. But again, how did they miss it? We'll get to that here in a bit. But Isaiah 53, follow along with me hopefully there. Isaiah is when they're in exile. They're being punished for their sins because they've more or less neglected God. They've walked away and they're dealing with this. And through Isaiah, God gives several prophecies about things to come, about his deliverance, things they don't fully understand, but they're trying to process. It says this, Isaiah 53. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Since he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He didn't have an impressive form or majesty that we should look at him. You see, no appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men. A man of suffering who knew what sickness was, who was like someone people turned away from. He was despised and we didn't value him. Yet he bore our sickness and he carried our pains. And when we in turn regarded him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was pierced because of our rebellion, crushed because of our iniquities. Punishment for our peace was on him. And we are healed by his wounds. We all went astray like sheep. We all have turned to our own way. And the Lord has punished him for the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter and like a sheep silent before the shearers, he did not open his mouth. He was taken away because of the oppression and judgment. And who considered his fate? For he was cut off from the land of the living. He was struck because of his people's rebellion. He was assigned a grave with the wicked. But he was with the rich man at his death because he had done no violence and had not spoken deceitfully. Yet the Lord was pleased to crush him severely. You see, when you make a guilt offering, he will see his seed. He will prolong his days. And by his hand, the Lord's pleasures will be accomplished. For after his anguish, he will see light and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will carry their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him the many as a portion, and he will receive the mighty as a spoil. because he willingly submitted to death and was counted among the rebels, yet he bore the sins of many and interceded for the rebels. This is a prophetic word about a servant that would come to deliver his people and do something. Four different times in Isaiah, God speaks of this person. And it's something that we, in hindsight, you can see. You ever seen a movie and you so, you know, I can see the characteristics all, but I see it all now once I see the finished product. But until you see the finished product, you just can't appreciate it. We're watching old movies with my kids now that we loved and grown up with, and now as we watch it and they're becoming aware of what's going on, we're like, man, I see it all along the way now. You can't miss it. And at the time they're reading this, they're like, well, I don't understand what this means. How is this going to be a better David? How is this going to be accomplished? How can this possibly be heroic? We see different things I want to point out. Sorry, my allergies getting the best of me. Verses 1 through 3, we see how he's possibly the hero. First thing we see is this, is he became worthless so that I could be counted as worthy. And notice it said he was a nobody. Like he was like just a little rut from the ground that came up. That root from the ground is like a little springling that comes up from the root of a tree that you would simply just chop off. It's worthless. It's not sightly at all. He's like, man, it should have been cut off. Like there was nothing impressive about him, nothing about his majesty that we'd look at him and go, man, that is something to be worthwhile. Jesus was a nobody so that I could be a somebody. Do you not realize all those worthless feelings, all of the feelings of inadequacy, Jesus bore upon himself so that I could be looked at as someone worthy upon God? How easy would it have been for a mighty, powerful, all great-looking, has all sorts of stuff, person coming like, well, of course, that's who the Messiah is. This is a nobody. This is a guy that even his own family said, there's no way this is the Messiah. He faced rejection. He faced difficulties. Not only was he became worthless so that I could become worthy, verse 4 through 6, we see that also that he became sin so that I could become sinless. Look at all the language of us. Not Jesus says, yet he bore what? Our sickness. He carried our pains because of our rebellion, because of our iniquities, because of our peace, to our own way, the iniquity of us all. Notice he doesn't talk about other people's. I mean, himself. He's talking about other people. He bore other people's sin and shame so that I could be counted as sinless. We sometimes don't view sin as a sickness or a cancer. But when you read throughout Scripture, you see time and time again that it sounds kind of like that. Listen to what Paul would say in Romans chapter 7. Just listen to how he describes this sickness in him. He said, sin rules in me as if it were slaves. I do not understand the things I do. I do not do the good things I want to do, and I do the bad things I hate to do. And if I do not want to do the bad things I do, but I am not really the one who is doing these bad things, it is sin living in me that does these things. Yes, I know that nothing good lives in me. I mean, nothing good lives in the part of me that is earthly and sinful. I want to do the things that are good, but I do not do them. He says, I do not do the good things I want to do. I do the bad things I do not want to do. So if I do things I do not want to do, then I'm not the one doing these things. It's sin living in me that's doing these bad things. So I've learned this rule. When I want to do good, evil is there with me. Like what a miserable person I am. Who will save me from this body that brings up death? God will. I thank him for saving me through Jesus Christ our Lord. Well, listen, there is sin that makes us a sick person, but Christ came to bear our sins so that we could be considered sinless and we could be delivered from that sort of thing. You see, in verse 7 through 9, not only does that, but he also becomes wretched so that I become righteous. It says he's oppressed, he's afflicted, he was cut off. Remember in Leviticus when we talk about the scapegoat that would come in, they would confess the sin, and they would cast them outside of the community. Jesus Christ became our scapegoat. He became the blood sacrifice. He became those things. He became such a wretched thing that it was saying, listen, we don't want him in our company. Jesus bore that when that was really mine to bear. Last but not least, you see as well, verse 10 through 12, that he became a sacrifice so that I could be saved. It says the Lord was pleased to crush him. That makes God sound wicked, like he's angry with him, but the reality is saying this, it was God's will that this would happen. In other words, where did this take place? Back in Genesis 3, when God says, listen, I'm going to raise someone up. It was God's will this would all come together. He'd be our guilt offering. He said, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will carry the iniquities of them all. Because he willingly submitted to death and counted among the rebels, he bore the sins of many and interceded for the rebels. Listen, there's a reality that because of what Jesus did, when God sees me because I've asked him to be my Savior, because I've submitted my life to him, God doesn't see me, he sees his perfect son. And when God looks at Jesus, he doesn't see his perfect son, he sees the wretched person of Eric that does all the things that I know I shouldn't do. It's like a coat I put on, and God looks at me. And so when God tells the son, man, this is my son who I'm well pleased, God's looking at me and saying, Jesus did all that so I could bear these things. Jesus is the hero I need. Now you might say, well, how is this referring to Jesus? Like, how did the Jews miss it? The people who knew scripture inside and out, how could they possibly miss this? And the answer is this. Sometimes we can get so focused on the thing we want that we completely neglect the things that we need. You know what I'm saying? Not long ago, we just moved. And we had a window where we sold our house and we bought a house. And we had a pretty big window in between and lived with in-laws until that time come. Now, when we did that, we had a pretty sizable amount from a house that we sold that went into a checking account. Can I tell you, for about that long, I felt rich. It was fun. I took pictures of my bank account. I'm like, look at that. Never going to see that again. Now, I'm not going to lie to you. I had some pretty serious conversations that my wife didn't go on the trail with me. And I said, listen, I know this needs to be a down payment, but you know how cool of a truck this could buy? We've always wanted to go to Italy. I'm just saying, like, I need to see the Holy Land, I think. I mean, I'm trying to tell you if there's any. I even try to put a religious. Jesus wants me, when I talk about the stuff, he wants me to know firsthand what it looks like. I'm trying to convince her why we need it. When I just want that sort of stuff, I need to not be in debt and put a good down payment on a house right here. You see, it's funny how quickly you can begin to justify and talk about things you want when you realize it's not really what you need. Why do they never see Jesus? Because they're so fixated on David that they never keep their eyes open for the possibility. In other words, the problem is we don't recognize the real problem. We sometimes think the problem is my difficulties in life, my situations, when in reality, it's not those sort of things. We can't distinguish the difference between a symptom and a problem. Let me say it like this. One of my pastors I served with, I remember for a while when we were with him, like he would have headaches that he couldn't explain. He'd just get there like, man, my head hurts. I can't really explain what's going on. He had all these weird symptoms. I remember we took him out on a boat and stuff, and the waves, like, it made him dizzy, and he got really sick. We couldn't figure out what was going on. Well, one day he was working out, and he had a seizure. Took him to the hospital, and they took him to the hospital and found out he had a tumor on the front of his brain the size of a softball. You see, the symptoms were coming in, and headaches and dizziness and stuff like that. The problem was he had cancer on the brain. And now imagine him going, listen, I don't really care about the cancer. I just want you to fix the dizziness. I want you to take care of this. When the real problem is the cancer on the brain that needs to be removed. Too often we get so focused on the symptoms in life that we don't recognize the real problem. Can I just say this real quick? Do you recognize the real problem in your life? Like, we spend so much time praying for God to fix our symptoms. God, would you fix my broken relationships? Would you fix my broken marriage? God, would you fix this addictions in my life? Man, I just wish I could stop being addicted to these sort of things. I wish I could stop. I wish you could fix their addiction. I wish you could stop this heart. I wish you could stop this pain and suffering. We look at the symptoms and pray for God's deliverance, and we don't realize the real problem is sin. Those are all fallouts from sin that came. Like, have you been following the story I've been telling? Because if you haven't, you're not going to understand the importance of Jesus. Like, follow along. God created a perfect world with perfect people, with perfect harmony, with no death, no heartache, no pain, no feelings of inadequacy. Those things you could wish you'd get rid of, they didn't exist. They weren't there. And mankind's sin destroyed that perfection. Their sin corrupted every aspect of this earth that we see and we face. And God promised in that moment, says, listen, I'm going to make things right. I'm going to promise to come and rescue and redeem the world, my people. I'm going to come and save you. Well, how do you make things perfect again? You remove the thing that made it imperfect. What's that? It's sin. You don't start focusing on the symptoms. You remove the core issue, what's causing it, the sin. How do you get rid of sin? He talks about later, someone has to pay the price to remove the sin. What's the price? It's life. We have nothing to offer God that says, listen, this is good. It's the very life we have. Someone has to pay that price. The debt price of sin is life, and we can't pay it. And so God promises a hero to come and rescue and redeem the world from their sin. How does a hero remove that sin? By prosperity? By great living? By an established kingdom? They have to pay the price. What's the price? They have to give their life. Now follow with me. How can someone pay a price if they have a debt of their own? How can I pay your debt when I got debt? Do I just add it on top of my debt? No. How do I have to be debt free. I have to have equity. I have to have more to do it. You just have to have someone that didn't sin, that lived a perfect life, that did everything right, that did everything so they can pay for my debt and their debt and all debt. The hero has to be debt free. In scripture, we talk about this is perfect. So enters Jesus into the scene. This lowly no one, but he is debt-free. He's the Son of God. He's the perfect sacrificial lamb who had no debt but paid my debt. You say, well, how can that person pay my debt and for everyone else? I get he can pay for one person. How does he do that? The beauty is in the resurrection. Jesus didn't just die, but we see the rest of the story. What? He rose from the grave. Proving what? That he is the Son of God and that he could do it again and again and again and again. Death has no power over him. Now what happens when we need this kind of deliverance, but we're focused on, man, comfort and life support, man, if I could just have this perfect kingdom, if I could just have establishment and all this sort of stuff, you miss it. You miss it. As much as we want to look at the Jewish people and judge them and go, man, how did you miss it? How many of us do the same thing? Man, God, would you just fix this heartache in my life? Would you just fix this? Would you make my life easy? Would you make my life comfortable? Would you make my life happy? When you don't realize that the real issue is the problem is sin. Jesus is the unlikely hero we need. And so your question comes is, well, how can I get this hero to save me? I love scripture makes it clear. Listen to this. This is the message of faith. It comes from Romans chapter 10 that we proclaim. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. You see, one believes with the heart, resulting in righteousness, and one confesses with the mouth, resulting in salvation. For the scripture says, everyone who believes on him will not be put to shame, since there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, because the same Lord of all richly blesses all who call him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Can I go back to first grade Bible for you? How do you do it? You admit that my sins is what caused this world to be the way it is. Man, that wickedness I see over there, listen, my sin played a role in this. This death and shame, my sin, in a way, played a part of this. You believe, I believe that I can't save myself. I can't do it. I've tried, and I've gotten a long ways, I think. But when I begin to look at it, I'm even longer ways away. I can't do it, but I believe that Jesus Christ came and was this perfect sacrifice, did it all. So what do? I confess what? That I need a hero, and I'm not it. Different way of saying this, you submit your life to the lordship and kingship of him. I want to live in his kingdom. I got to let him be my king. In other words, you got to give everything to him. Now, people hear that and they immediately go, hold on a second. People tell me all the time, salvation is free. Why are you asking something for me? You misunderstand free. It's not that it's free, as in you don't have to do anything. It means it's freely given to whoever wants it. That's what he talked about. It doesn't matter, Jew, Greek, no matter what your background is, no matter where you came from, everyone's offered this gift. But can I tell you something? Coming to Jesus will cost you everything. Because you can't come and call him Lord and still hold on to the other life and say, man, I still want this other stuff. It costs you everything. The problem is this, you can't call Jesus King and Lord and still be chasing after David. You can't do it. Either you submit to who God is and worship him, or you continue to chase after David. And can I tell you what I've seen is only one of those kings can save you. And many of us don't see ourselves in that light. We don't realize that we've created a God of our own making that's not in Scripture. We're chasing after a King David that we're like, this is God. No, that's not God in Scripture that I read about. I don't get to decide what is right or wrong. I don't get to decide. God decides that. And I have to submit to his lordship, his kingship, and say, hey, what's your will be done? It's it. And so my question to you is this, and it's plain and simple. It's my last question, and we're done. Here's this. Who is your hero? who is your king? Like, who or what are you looking for today? If you would honestly look at yourself like, man, am I chasing after the Son of God, the perfect Lamb that is the unlikely hero that I never expected, or am I still looking for this King David that I hope will come and be everything that I want him to be? The beauty is when we submit to the Lordship of God, the true King, can I tell you what we find? We find that he ends up being everything we ever needed and more. We never give him a shot. Some of you today need to make that decision. You're waiting for the next David to come. Guess what? Keep waiting. It's going to be a bit. So some of you today need to come and say, listen, God, I understand that I need you to be my hero. I understand all these things are symptoms of the real issue, which is sin in my life and that has affected me and the whole world, and I want you to save me from that. And God saves us in the sense that we are saved, but God comes and delivers the world later on in Scripture. The story's not done yet, and we'll see more about that. But the question is, what do you want today? For you who call yourself children of God and have received Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, listen, quit calling him king, but keep chasing after a David. Quit getting angry that he's not David. He's not David. He is Jesus Christ. Make him Lord. Let him be Lord. So I'm going to ask where you're at. Just bow your heads, close your eyes, and take a second. We're going to have elders available for a time for you to respond. The band's going to come up just to give us some time to worship. And I just ask you to just, in your heart right now, wherever you are, just to ask yourself this question, who am I looking for? What do I honestly feel like I need to be saved from? Do you have confidence that you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Or are you still chasing after David? It's sad that many Christians look at Jesus, call him Jesus, but really thinking about David. So maybe today you need to come give your life to him and ask for saving. So I'm going to pray for you the confidence to get up, whether you're saved or not, just so maybe you need to come talk to someone and just get some guidance and help. I pray you do that. Father God, I love you. I praise you for the truth of your word. God, the whole story we've been reading has been, this is it. This is the crescendo. This is the big picture. This is it. And if we don't get excited about this, there's nothing else to get excited about. There's no other gospel to be presented. God, help these people understand that Jesus Christ is it. That's it. It's the answer. There's nothing else. If they're waiting for something else, God, they're going to be sadly let down. But I pray today they'd come and submit their life to you as their Lord, their King. I pray they'd come and confess their need for you in the areas of life that they truly need healing. If there's anybody in the sound of my voice, Lord, who has never done that, I pray they'd come and talk to one of our elders, myself, and say, can you just tell me how to be saved? And we'll walk them through what it looks like. For the people in this room who are children of God, who have been chasing after a David, God, help them to let that go. And begin chasing after you. And God, for those who've been chasing after you and doing what's right, God, I pray they'd pray for the people around them. And I pray they'd worship what they have. Thank you for such an amazing story. I love you so much. Help us to respond. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I'm going to ask if you stand. If you feel like you need to pray with someone, you need to come to the front, pray, whatever you need to do. Like, listen, we got JD, we got Pete up here. I'll be up here. Ask Tiffany if she needs to be available to come up here. Like, you come up and pray. Any students, you want to come talk to Josiah or Bethany. Don't make an excuse that no one's up there, that you can't come. But you come, you be faithful, but you respond. Let's worship.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you.
I worship you. I worship you. Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Stop working. You never.
Well, amen. Praise God that he is a hero we need. You can be seated for just a couple of moments. If you were a visitor with us today, we are so thankful that you have chosen to worship with us today. And just a reminder, if you haven't filled out a Connect card, you can do that at the host table at the back. We'd just love to get a little information from you. We've got a gift we'd like to give you, just a welcome gift, saying thank you for being here. And we'd just love to be able to connect with you guys and see if there's any ways we can be reaching out to you this week.
Yeah, well, here at North Point, we believe that giving is an act of worship. And so as normal church, when you give, you can give in two ways, either online, northpoint.tv/give, or with the baskets in the back.
Don't forget, tonight is Fall Fest. Woo-hoo! And so it starts at 4 o'clock. And so if you are helping out, just so you know that this afternoon at 3:45, we have a leaders huddle, a volunteer huddle. So if you are doing a trunk, if you're going to be welcoming people in, you need to be here in place at 3:45. That means your trunk needs to be ready to go at 3:45. That way we are ready, set, and we can welcome people in. If you don't have a costume that you are wearing tonight, we would encourage you to wear your North Point shirt. And that way, if you put on some white sneakers, you can come dressed up as Eric. But please, church family, if you have one of those shirts, please wear that, bring that. That way, this is a way for us to reach out to our community. This is our home, and this is a way for us to be good hosts so that they know that we are here to serve them. So please wear that shirt. Please come. Even if you don't have kids who are going to be participating in the activities, that means you are all free to come and just meet and love on others. And so please come be a part of that.
That's good. That's good. Hey, if you are a visitor with us, if you've been attending for a while and you're like, hey, I think I want to make this church my home, you are in luck. This Wednesday night, we're going to be having our new to North Point class. Eric, what time is that again? Where is he? 6 o'clock. There we go. There we go. This week, this Wednesday, 6 o'clock, new to North Point. Come check it out. And then that is the first step in coming in becoming a member here at North Point. So you can sign up at northpoint.tv/events.
Awesome. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for who you are. Lord, I thank you that you are the hero we need. Lord, I know so many times in my own life I try to be the hero. So many times in my own life I try to mold you into who I think you ought to be. But Lord, I thank you that you are better than who we think you need to be. Lord, I thank you that you sent your son to save us, the unlikely hero, but the hero we needed. Lord, I thank you for this time of gathering together as your people in worship today. And God, I pray that as we leave this place today, we'd be better followers of you. We'd walk more closely with you. We'd walk more in love with you because of this time spent together worshiping you today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You guys are dismissed.